I feel Bobby Shmurda is a typical young kid who born into a crazy neighborhood and some crazy circumstances, and he's trying to survive and figure it out.
It's almost like a war zone. People are every day hearing gunfire.
So a lot of people will say that Bobby Shmurda unfortunately couldn't escape his past, but also Bobby was just so young.
If he committed those acts, those violent acts that he's accused of doing, then yes, he's got to go to jail.
When I first met him, I really liked him. I liked him as a person. I don't like all my clients, but I actually liked him. He had a genuineness and authenticity about him as a person. He had a certain, you know, you can tell he had been through some things in his life, but you could tell he was tough. He learned, and he was a warrior.
I think Bobby Shmurda is a talented guy. I met him a couple of times under his managers. My name is Derek Parker, and I started and created the unit they call the Hip Hop Police. I had a great deal of knowledge of the music industry, so the chief wanted me to create a unit to deal exclusively with the music industry and the violence, and to stop it. Bobby Shmurda is a young guy who came from East Flatbush, Brooklyn, and he rose into the rap music industry, making one of the Shmurda dance song. Everybody kind of took to that song pretty quickly.
When Hot first started to blow up, honestly, phenomenon is really the only word I could use to describe it. I remember he dropped the song, I believe it was late March 2014, and then someone looped the song in June. And a month later, he had a deal with Epic Records. By August of that summer, I believe the Vine had over 3 million loops, and the video for his song actually had over 11 million views. And it was definitely a great song, very catchy, but I think social media absolutely is what caused that song to skyrocket. It's amazing how quickly he blew up from that.
Things are looking up for Bobby Shmurda as last night he inked a deal with Epic Records.
I think a lot of people miss, but I don't think those executives at Epic did, is when you watch these videos of Bobby and his crew, and you see how organic it was and that youthful energy, that's why they signed him.
When you have celebrities like Rihanna and Justin Bieber on their yachts dancing to your track, it's on Jimmy Fallon, you know what I mean? I think the dance is what really, really pushed that song over the top.
Shorty, give me nothing till I pass out. I swear to God, all I do is cash out. And if you ain't a hoe, get up on my track.
So we were covering him as the song was blowing up. Encountered him on red carpets a few times. So Bobby honestly just seemed like a kid who was having the time of his life, and he was.
And he was always affiliated with the Crips gang from East Flatbush. GS9 was basically, becoming very popular. I heard of a lot of shootings that happened. I think there was something like over 20 shootings alleged to be part of this crew, the Crips crew in Brooklyn. And these guys are a gang.
They join these gangs because they do not feel they have any other protection. They don't trust the police. In many cases, they've seen or heard firsthand of some dealings that were very much reasons to not trust the police. So they join the gangs because of that.
Whenever you're affiliated or involved with something like that, the police take a look at you because the number of shootings and the violence that occurs with you as your name, a famous rapper, and the people you hang with brings a lot of notoriety to the police department.
When the news broke that he got arrested, honestly, I remember being at work and being stunned.
Can you do the shmoney dance?
No, but I know how to count that shmoney.
He was arrested outside of his studio in Midtown Manhattan. Pollard was charged with conspiracy to commit murder, weapons possession, and a variety of other conspiracy counts, and a reckless endangerment count.
Defendants charged in the narcotics conspiracy include Akil Pollard, also known as Bobby Shmurda.
I think I was immediately worried that he was going to have a hard time getting out of these charges.
Today we're announcing the arrest and indictment of 15 individuals associated with the G-Stone Crips, or GS9.
Whether or not GS9 was a gang, to use that parlance, was a sort of an open question. Prosecutors argued that it was. We pointed out factors that suggested it wasn't. Factors such as that they filed for a record label, that they had lawyers involved in that process, that the GS9 name was out there and they were speaking about it publicly.
What they do is they target you like a gang. You're a gang. And the way they go about taking you down and calling dismantling you is they put together a schematic of who's involved in this gang and what persons, and Bobby Shmurda happened to be very famous, so he was part of this GS9 crew.
There really is no way at this time to know what, if any, impact his fame had on the activity related to this case, the focus on this case. Obviously, when a case becomes more high profile, more resources are devoted, more eyes are on it, and it often does take a different path.
You have the problems of gun violence and the inundating of our communities with guns. On top of that, some bad cops. So you almost feel like you're under siege from cops and robbers. Now, it's not to say all cops are bad, but when you look at these issues of policing, people are growing up with so much stress and anxiety that it's almost unbearable.
So according to some reports, police used social media to pinpoint his location and possibly tie him to some illegal activities. And unfortunately, that seems to happen to a lot of people these days.
In most cases involving teenagers and young adults, social media is a tool that's been used dozens of times in major high-profile cases, and we're just going to see it being used more and more.
He was just a kid, like, having so much fun, like, having all this newfound fame. He wasn't able to turn off that switch. Shmurda's new trial date is now set for September 12th, but the dates never really seem to stick. So I actually did try to go see Bobby Shmurda at Rikers, really just tell his side of the story, because we knew that he was in a very difficult position. It took me about 3 hours to get through security. And I'm finally sitting in the room waiting for my turn to go see him. And then a guard comes down with a note, "Bobby doesn't want to see you." And I was shocked because we had cleared it with his mom. And the reason was, he doesn't know who you are. And I understood it because I could understand how he wouldn't be very trusting of a stranger after everything he's been through.
They're cut off from their families, they're cut off from their supports, and they have a lot of alone time, a lot of thinking time, and a lot of time to allow that stress and the severity of the situation to build. Mr. Pollard was facing not just decades, but perhaps a life behind bars if he were convicted. When you know those are the outcomes and the likely result of a guilty verdict, it is a very strong factor in considering what legal advice to give somebody.
As of September 9th, Bobby Shmurda has accepted a plea deal in his conspiracy case in New York that will land him in prison for 7 years.
So although Bobby obviously wasn't happy with the plea deal at the end of the day, I think he did the right thing compared to the other members of his crew who got really awful sentences because they decided not to take the plea. One of them got 117 to 130 years in prison. One of them got 98. Another one got 53 years.
Mr. Pollard pled simply to a possession of a weapon and a conspiracy to possess that weapon. Akil's plea did lessen the sentence for Rowdy, and I have no doubt that that was an important consideration. Mr. Pollard was sentenced to 7 years. The 7 years also is reduced by the significant time he's already served and by his good behavior inside of jail. And so we expect him to serve a 3-year approximate sentence.
You know what it is? It is a shame, but he's a product of his environment, what he grew up at. I mean, his history about his father, I think being in and out of the prison system and going to jail. I might say, you know, some of these kids in these neighborhoods, when they grow up, they can't let go of it. You know, there's a certain lifestyle that they live, and they don't move on.
So a lot of people will say that Bobby Shmurda, unfortunately, couldn't escape his past. And I'm sure there are many reasons for that. But also, Bobby was just so young.
When I was growing up, the cultural figures was Muhammad Ali standing up to the war, and James Brown, say it loud, I'm black and I'm proud, and Marvin Gaye, what's going on? Their cultural figures were romanticizing killing, shooting. I'll put a cap in your butt. So this was their role model.
I think he needed more time to figure out how to calm down. Maybe he needed more positive role models in his life. In a few more years, he could have maybe escaped, like really fully moved out of the hood and like changed his life and rolled with a different group of friends. But it just all happened so quickly. I'm not sure how plausible it would have been for him to break out of that mentality.
If I think he knew what he knew now, he would probably do things differently. He probably wouldn't have been involved so much with certain people. And most of these rappers have to learn that if you make it in this industry, you can't take everyone with you. You have to move up. I know it's hard to say that because this guy grew up with you, he ran with you. But when you start to make it, and the bigger you are, the bigger you become. And the things that you do out here in the street get magnified 100 times.
For the first time since taking the deal, the Brooklyn-born rapper spoke candidly with Complex to discuss the sentence. We look guilty in these orange jumpsuits. If you put Al Sharpton in an orange jumpsuit and accuse him of having a gun, he's going to be found guilty.
Prisons and the condition that people serve in are very, very difficult and trying. I think we're all hopeful he gets through it and gets through it okay.
Look, there's always a space for a rapper returning from prison to be successful in rap. It's hard to transition from prison and still be successful, but we saw Remy Ma do it. You know, she murdered 2016, her and Fat Joe. So I think people will still be there to support him.
He has a hell of a lot of perspectives and experiences in life, but he clearly should have more to continue growing and evolving and developing. And I also don't think people have really gotten to see who he is. People have no idea who this kid is.
And I'm hopeful that once this is all over, that he has a very bright future still ahead of him.
He still has a big fan base. I don't think that's gonna fade away. People might forget about him over the next few years, but I think at the time of release, if he does come home, I think there will be an avenue for him. It's just really up to him at that point. Will he have changed and matured enough in prison to come back and do things the right way, to not make the same mistakes, to be smarter? Or will he withdraw too much and become more hostile? And will it be worse? I think a lot of it will depend on his mental state in the next few years.
This is something we've got to solve. It's not a thing that we have an option of. Gun violence is not an option in terms of should we deal with it or not. We have to, because we're losing far too many people.